Hello, everybody. I'm Christopher Anello, Federal Healthcare Manager for Solution Consulting. This is the fourth session of our Roadmap to Resiliency webinar series. Today, we're going to touch on analytics, intelligence, and robotics. Today, we're going to have Christian Malone. He's our Federal ITX Solution Architect who helps deliver value to our customers in all of the IT products. And Dan Grady, who is our special solution architect, specialist in analytics and machine learning. So we talked about in the last three sessions on the new normal and how federal agencies are facing new challenges with COVID and how to be able to respond to the new challenges, and then how to get ready for any future situations that might be similar, and how to build resiliency into your organization for any future major event. Obviously, the current situation has caused a lot of our employees to go work from home and making sure that they are safe, but as well as all our systems and software and solutions are available for the continuous delivery of the mission. In the readiness side, we kind of discussed yesterday about kind of vulnerability, risk management, your coup plans, and just having a good posture on what's your potential risk and how to plan for disasters when they do happen and how you can transition your key staff or your teams over to those situations. But also part of readiness is having visibility into your systems and into your organization to make those quick decisions and be ready to react. So today we'll be touching a little more on that side of the house as how the capabilities of the ServiceNow platform on top of the ITX capabilities we have talked about before can be enhanced with analytics, machine learning, and predictive intelligence that we have in the platform. And we've said this before, that behind every workflow, behind every great experience is a great workflow. And so that's some of the things that we'll be touching on in the demonstration later today. The last session will be tomorrow on the front and middle back office, really to drive digital transformation. But in the readiness phase, we really want to make sure that we make sure our foundation of service delivery is strong and can sustain major challenges that we get in the environment. So ServiceNow at its core is a platform, and on that platform, we've built a lot of applications that are point solutions. And the beauty of ServiceNow single data model allows us to deliver these capabilities across all these multiple use cases and truly drive digital transformation. So in the context of being ready for situations that might happen, the more we automate these workflows and these business processes and have intelligence in what areas to improve, we can truly drive a digital transformation to move away from manual processes and legacy systems. Now, in the case of government, where a lot of those systems of record cannot be really changed or moved, but need to modernize the experience or the process that our employees have to face to drive mission outcomes, ServiceNow is in a great position with integrations to those systems to bring that data forward and drive a true business process transformation. So with no further ado, I would like to have Dan Grady talk about kind of some of those strategic priorities that we're aligned to in the context of readiness.
Thanks, Chris. All right, so when we look at our customers that are focused in that IT workflow and there's the strategic priorities that they're focused on right now, they're really focused on that reducing risk and increasing agility. They're focused on mission continuity and ultimately pursuing productivity. That platform that Chris just shared with you is uniquely positioned to help deliver on those priorities. And what we'll be doing for the rest of the session is focusing on how the platform can help with that operational excellence and improve experiences through smarter self-service-based options and self-healing processes powered by AI and automation. I mean, if we start digging into IT and think specifically about IT as an area where automation can have an immediate impact, we really can just focus in on incident reduction, right? When we look at incidents, there's two primary sources. One are those human-generated incidents that myself and Chris and Christian put in. And for most organizations, this is about 40% of the volumes that people see. And then there's those machine-generated systems, the ones that are generated by the systems themselves, and they make up the other 60% of those incidents that come in. For human-generated incidents, the demand is not just for more, but for smarter self-service options and faster turnaround times. On the machine side of the house, the goal is to use all the data that's constantly being generated by those machines. And now that data is at our disposal about the machines, we want to start predicting the problems before they happen and then resolve them before the users are ever even impacted. So that more proactive versus reactive approach to predict and prevent. So how do we automate away both those people and the machine-generated incidents? Well, of course, that powerful ServiceNow platform and the intelligent solutions on them are going to be part of the story. So what we're going to be doing inside of the demonstration today is looking at how we can use intelligent automation, AI, and its subset machine learning to not only shift to a larger percentage of the work being handled by automation, reducing the number of issues that need to be addressed in the first place, but then start looking at how we can prevent the fires rather than fight them constantly. And that'll free us up to focus on more automation opportunities, making our organization more resilient longer term. If we focus in on the ServiceNow platform itself and that middle box that Chris had brought up earlier, what we've been doing over the last several years is building out a layer of the ServiceNow platform focused on AI and machine learning capabilities. And there's different aspects of this layer that you'll see in the demonstration, but the core here, this core layer, each of the individual solution areas, today we're focusing in on IT and the IT operations management solutions, but you can also start the other areas of the platform like HR, customer service, field service management, and the custom applications you build yourselves also have the ability to dive in and take advantage of these AI capabilities on the ServiceNow platform. So you can start leveraging all this power and get more value out of the data that's flowing through the platform. From a demonstration perspective, we're going to be looking at four key components of that machine learning layer. We're going to be touching on the virtual agent, which is our in-platform conversational interface or chatbot, the portion of the platform that allows us to provide that always-on 24/7 service offering for our customers. We'll look at predictive intelligence, which is the brand name we give our different in-platform machine learning capabilities themselves. So there's a layer of machine learning frameworks on the platform. This is the portion of the platform that allows us to do things like automatically categorize or assign a ticket just based on the short description, automating some of the triaging process that goes on, or recommend to an agent that's working a ticket similar open or resolved incidents that might be able to help them resolve that issue they're focused on more quickly. Or one of the newer solutions that we offer out of the box from a machine learning perspective is something we call knowledge demand insights, which allows us to isolate incidents or tickets that don't have knowledge articles related to them and recommend areas in which you could create more valuable content or more useful knowledge articles to further deflect incidents from coming in the first place. Christian's going to dive into the AI ops solution to help us eliminate noise and look at a service owner workspace that helps us eliminate noise and prioritize alerts and private insights and automate some other machine generated incidents or the remediation of some machine generated tickets. And then we'll also look at the performance analytics solution on the platform. This is the portion of the platform that essentially tells us that everything else that we're doing is working or if it's not working. It's the piece that lets us set up organizational KPIs and metrics and align everyone in the organization to the business outcomes that we're trying to achieve, and then give them visibility into whether we have the momentum that we want towards those goals. And when we don't have the momentum that we want, the trends are not moving in the right direction, it's the piece that gives us visibility into the different opportunities to improve. So what I'll be doing is I'm going to be starting the demonstration on the performance analytics front. We'll look at some higher level dashboards for an executive and then an incident process owner, and then we'll move on out to look how we can get some of that information out to the people on the front lines. Then we'll transition over to look at some of the predictive intelligence solutions in action and how the machine learning surfaces itself inside of the workspaces. And then we'll get all the way out to the end user, where the virtual agent can help solve some problems. And then we're going to reel it all the way back in. I'll pass the ball to Christian, and he's going to work on the AAOps side of the house. So let's move on over to the demonstration portion. So we're going to start with performance analytics, and I'm going to break it down into a couple of different components. We'll look at this high-level executive dashboard real quick. We'll move on out to that incident process owner, and then we'll get out to the most neglected person when it comes to analytics, those people on the front lines. And when we think about executive-level dashboards, the goal with most executive-level dashboards is to provide that holistic view into the health of the business that he or she is responsible for. And that's what we've got on this screen here. Across the top of the screen, we give that an executive the view into where they stand as it relates to some key high-level business outcomes that they might be focused on. And these are real. This is real-time visibility, where we stand right now. But in addition to where we stand right now, we give them visibility into the target that we've set for themselves, so they have an understanding of where we're trying to get to, and the gap to that target, as well as the change from the prior period, so they can see whether we're moving in the right direction or not. As we move down the screen in this dashboard, we start giving them visibility into the momentum that we have around some key metrics that influence those outcomes that we're focused on. So if you think about something like customer satisfaction, if I just expand this for a second, some of the things that we're doing or tracking that influence customer satisfaction might be, let's say, rolling out a new knowledge base. And that's what we have here, people that are adopting the knowledge base. But if you think about it, knowledge adoption is just one piece of achieving that overall outcome. What is the impact that knowledge adoption is supposed to have? Well, it's supposed to drive self-service and reduce the number of tickets coming in. And it's also supposed to help us improve resolution times. So why not start layering those things on top of each other to help us to tell a more complete story with the data? Because if we're seeing an increase in the adoption of those self-service tools, but not a decrease in the other two areas, it speaks volumes about the quality of the information that we have inside of that knowledge base. And also it gives us some direction or some early warning signs that, you know what, we might not see that improvement in customer satisfaction that we thought we might see. And then lastly, as we move down this screen here, we give that executive visibility into the top or the bottom contributors in each of those individual areas, so they know where their biggest areas of opportunity or remediation may lie. So in one single screen, a tremendous amount of information to help give that executive a view into the health of their business. Now let's move on out for a second here, and we'll get out to, let's say, an incident process owner and look at what their view of their information might look like. And the first thing that you're going to notice about this screen is that this dashboard is going to look a little bit different than the last one that we had at the executive level. And that's because what we're trying to do with every dashboard that we roll out is give people visibility to information that's meaningful to them, things that they're supposed to be focusing on. Because if they don't believe that they can influence the numbers or the numbers don't help them do their job more effectively, it doesn't help us change their behavior. And it's those behavioral changes that we want to get with the data. So if I'm an incident process owner, I care about things like my backlog in real time, my first call resolution rate, and my mean time to resolve. And on any one of these widgets that you see inside of any one of these dashboards, you always have this ability in real time to drill down and get to this analytics hub that gives you pretty much anything and everything you'd ever want to know about a metric that you're focused on. So in this case here, we get visibility into where we stand right now from a backlog perspective, the target, the gap to that target, the change percentage. This blue line gives us the daily ups and downs of our backlog, and this orange line is giving us the overall trend for that given time period. And if I wanted to start looking at things for a different time period, let's say the last 1 month, I can look at that and notice that the overall trend is moving downwards. And I'll just bring everything back here. I have the ability to set targets. I have the ability to set thresholds and get notified if this metric hits an all-time high, an all-time low, or is less than or more than a certain value. I have the ability to add comments to communicate to people why the trend might be moving in a different direction. Maybe we got hit with a global pandemic and things are going to start increasing or decreasing. We want to make sure that we communicate to people that are looking at this information why things might be happening. Because you're using an in-platform analytics solution, you always have the ability in real time to get down to the detailed records themselves and take action on them, which is a huge advantage. And then lastly, you have the ability to start slicing and dicing any one of these metrics in different ways, whether it be priority, category, assignment group, to help you identify the opportunities to improve, where the bottlenecks might exist inside of the organization. And everything that we just went through there, that's all pre-built behavior on the platform. You simply turn on the analytics solution, start collecting data, and you get that level of visibility and interactivity with the information. The last thing that I'll call out on this one dashboard or this one here, because this is a good example of how that layering effect that we looked at earlier on the executive dashboard applies again. Many of us have initiatives to reduce our backlog, right? And if we were just looking at our backlog in isolation, right, we'd be high-fiving. Great job, everyone. We've reduced our backlog by 30 to 40% over the last month. But if you simply come in here and you layer the average age of open incidents on top of that backlog metric, the data now tells me a completely different story, right? at the same time that we're reducing our backlog, the average age of the tickets was rising. And why is that? Well, it's usually one of two things. One, human nature takes over. We're motivating people to reduce the backlog, so they start cherry picking the easy tickets, right? Or two, it's a data quality problem, right? Maybe we bulk loaded a bunch of machine generated incidents and they didn't get assigned properly or something like that. In either case, right, I had that same ability before to drill into this and look at what's contributing to that aging problem that I'm having. But more important than that, what's going to happen when these older tickets start closing? It's going to impact my mean time to resolve, which is going to skyrocket. And then that customer satisfaction score on my executive dashboard, that's going to be negatively impacted. Everything we do inside of the organization is interconnected in some way, shape, or form. What the analytics engine allows us to do is start communicating to the individual stakeholders the areas they should be focusing on and how they're contributing to the larger good. And now I'm going to move on out to that last persona here from an analytics perspective. The person on the front lines, those people typically get overlooked when it comes to analytics. And this is where your more traditional approaches to analytics really fall down, because the closer you get to the front lines, the less likely you are to get somebody to leave the system that they're doing work in to go look at numbers, right? And if we want to start driving people's behavior with data and help driving efficiencies into the organization, we need to put that data and the information in the flow of their day-to-day lives, which is what we've done here. Right, on the same screen in which I give this agent the work that they need to pick up, and I prioritize it by the score, which is something we call spotlight, and I'll come back to that in a second, I give them visibility into the trends that they're either being measured against or that the organization is focused on. And I know this is going to seem like a little thing, but it actually goes a long way in terms of driving and motivating behaviors. Right? You want people to understand that the work that they're doing has meaning. And I was telling this story the other day and showing this, and somebody said, Dan, that's kind of like the parable of the bricklayer. And I was like, what the heck is that? And they said, well, there's two guys building a brick wall. Somebody comes up and asks them what they're doing. First guy says, well, building a brick wall. Second guy says, I'm building a castle. Which of the two do you think is the more motivated individual? Probably the one building the castle. We want to give people line of sight into what we're trying to achieve organizationally so they know that the work has meaning. Now, I did call out this spotlight piece here. This is an important piece of the analytics engine that we provide that many customers often overlook. And what is spotlight? Well, it's a declarative scoring mechanism. And what the heck does that mean? What it means is it allows me to take multiple aspects of a record. In this case, it's an incident, and combine them together to create a holistic score that I can use for prioritization and ranking. So in this case, I've got a queue of work that needs to get done. This one moved to the top of the list. It got a score of 1950. And where did that score come from? Well, that score was made up of a number of different factors. This ticket got 500 points because it was a P1, 1,000 points because it hadn't been updated in 30 days, another 150 because it was on Amazon, another 100 because the description was empty. All those things together moved that ticket to the top of the list and told that agent to focus on this thing first, eliminating the need for them to analyze the data rather than just, and we just get them working the data as quickly as possible. It's something we call spotlight. It's super powerful, and you can apply it to many use cases to help you identify where your biggest opportunity might be or where you should be spending your time. Now, while I'm here at the agent level, let's take a look at some of the machine learning that can be embedded to help streamline the way they do their jobs. I'm going to just open up a new incident here and add my caller, Abel Tudor. Abel, come on, Abel. Oh, I put a period there. Abel Tudor. And I'm just going to quickly enter a short description here, something like can't log into Workday Analytics. And I watch what happens when I enter that short description. Over here on the right-hand side of the screen, I've got this Agent Assist tab. And what this allows me to do is it's going to start surfacing relevant information to the agent to help them solve this problem. One of the things that they have the ability to do readily and real quickly right here is say, hey, go find me similar open or resolved incidents. Now, you're going to see that I do this demonstration quite a few times. So many of the similar incidents are going to be the same name. But in your organization, you can see where that would be helpful because, hey, it's rare that something's happening for the first time in an organization. If we've already solved that problem, let's let the user know or the agent know that there's a solution out there that potentially could benefit them, streamlining that resolution process. The other thing that potentially would happen in this panel with machine learning, if this was a living, breathing instance, is if there was a lot of incidents coming in at the same time with similar descriptions, it would notify the agent right here that they potentially should propose a major incident to be raised right in that same panel. And now watch what happens when I save this incident or commit it to the system. You're going to see that I get notified that it's been categorized and assigned. So this We predicted the software category for this ticket, as well as the HR systems support group for this ticket. That was using machine learning behind the scenes. So based on the short description, it predicted the category in the assignment group, automating some of that triage process and saving some time. A recent customer of mine told me that they rolled this out and they just used predicting category and subcategory. And in the first month of rolling this out, they saw 86% accuracy in the predictions, and they estimated the savings of about 100 hours of triage time just by predicting those two things. Now, the last use case that I'll show here from a predictive intelligence standpoint, or I want you to get visibility into, is that knowledge demand insights use case that I mentioned earlier. So what's happening here is, let's say you're a knowledge owner or a service owner. What this will do is it'll go out, it'll look at all the incidents that were created that don't have knowledge articles as part of the solution, whether that be attached or referenced in the solution. And it will use the similarity framework to take that set of incidents and see if there's any knowledge articles out there that could have been applied. It takes that subset of incidents, and then it uses the clustering framework on the platform to cluster them together and produce this visual, which gives me the top clusters in terms of incidents that don't have knowledge articles. And I can drill into any one of these clusters. It'll take me down to a detailed list of the incidents that make up that cluster. In this case, I've got 212. I can click this button to shrink that 212 down to the 20 that is closest to the center of the cluster. And then right from here, I create what is known as a knowledge gap task or a knowledge demand task to get somebody to look at this and say, hey, see if an article can be created. And now that kicks off the workflow to get an article created and get this problem solved, or get an article out there so we can start deflecting or providing a self-service option moving forward. It's just an example of a machine learning solution we provide on the platform that helps streamline a painful process that many people are going through today manually. Now, last piece here. So we've looked at performance analytics and some of the metrics and how we can start aligning people to what we're trying to achieve. We looked at how we can embed some machine learning inside of a process to help streamline the resolution of incidents. And now let's look at how we can start using AI and machine learning via the virtual agent or an in-platform conversational interface to start better servicing people in an automated way. So let's come here. I'm going to launch my virtual agent. And the first thing that you're going to see here, I'm going to say no, hold on. Yep, had a good experience. The first thing that you'll see, actually, this is the third thing that you're now going to see since I was already in here when I start a new conversation with the virtual agent. It's going to ask how it can help, and then I'm going to get a little button that says show me everything. Now, this is going to seem like a little thing, but it actually goes a long way in terms of creating a great experience. When I click on that, I just get a list of all the different things that the virtual agent can help me with. And like I said, seems like a little thing, but how often have you been interacting with a chatbot, going back and forth four or five times, only to find out that it can't help you with that item that you want to be helped with? So we give you that ability right up front to expose to the user the things that the virtual agent can help them with, just in case they're interested. Or they can simply come in here and start typing away what they want information for. In this case, I asked about current service outages. Our natural language understanding engine under the covers recognizes he's interested or she is interested in service disruptions, goes out, gets that information from the ServiceNow platform, or presents it back to the user. Maybe right from here, I want to use the virtual agent to open a ticket and say something like, you know what, I have an IT issue. First thing this will do is it'll recognize that this person wants to create an incident, and it'll ask me for a short description. I'll say something like, you know what, I struggle with email recovery. So go out. By default, it tries to search the knowledge base. This could be a downstream benefit of that knowledge demand insights that it's the virtual agent is able to provide better information to potentially help resolve the issue. And I'm going to say no, none of those articles resolved my problem because I want to continue the demonstration. I'll enter an urgency. And that's all it needs to create the incident on my behalf. And then you'll notice this got categorized and assigned. I didn't enter that information. And that was way too fast for a human being to do that. Again, there's that machine learning or predictive intelligence behind the scenes, categorizing and assigning the incident, creating a better experience from a user perspective, and streamlining the resolution path. Maybe I want to check the status of my incidents. Using contextual information, it knows who I am, and it's going to be able to get that information for me. I've clearly done this demonstration a few times, 82 to be exact. I can get the information about my incident, and right from here, I can not only check the status, but I can update the status and add some commentary. So I'll just say, no big deal, and move along. And now, second to last piece that we'll do here, is there anything else one of the benefits or one of the things that you do on the ServiceNow platform to streamline things is you create a service catalog that's got automations behind it and workflows behind it to automate the fulfillment of tasks and things. The virtual agent can simply extend that and you can start doing things like, let's say, order a red stapler. And what this will do, this is going to go out, it's going to search my knowledge base, it's going to find me that item and then step me through the process of ordering that item from the service catalog right here in line inside of the virtual agent. Automated fulfillment. Or another popular automated fulfillment, we're actually viewing Microsoft, this webinar, viewing Microsoft Teams. Maybe I want to add a new MS team. And right from within the virtual agent, I can go in there and I can start, what's the name of the team? Well, the team will be Christian's Amazing Demonstration. Go out, it's going to create that, it's going to ask me one more thing. What is the initial message you'd like to post? Well, prepare to be amazed by the power of AI ops. The virtual agent has gathered the necessary information, and then behind the scenes, it kicks off the workflow to create that team on my behalf, and it also gives me some additional information to help me understand how best to maximize that team's environment through a knowledge article that we've created on the platform. I'll say, no, there's nothing else that it can assist with, and then it's going to ask me what my experience was, and of course, it was good. It was better than good. It was great. With that, I'm going to pass it over to Christian to take you through the AI ops portion of this demonstration conversation. Christian, you out there?
I am. Thank you very much. Let me go and share my screen now. Let me know when that's coming through, okay?
You are good. I see you.
Great.
See you flow.
Dan, thank you very much. Thanks for the handoff. So I wanted to go a little bit more in depth first around what was happening behind the scenes that Dan was showing you. And to give you an idea from an automation perspective, what we can do with our integration hub and our spokes and our flow designer. So behind the scenes, you have this this workflow engine. And in fact, what we'd like to do is tell a quick vignette about the founding of our company where we went off and the founder of the company had a group of developers and had essentially built a workflow engine and went to a few, you know, very first potential customers, showed it to them and they asked what they could do with it. And the story is, of course, that it's an automation engine. The answer is anything. What do you want to do with it? And it kind of went around a few times, probably who's on first there, and then ended up with, okay, well, we'll go build something to show you an example of what it could do. And that was an ITSM solution, a strong background in ITSM at the time with the team members. So that's effectively how we became an ITSM company. That was the very first application that our workflow engine was tasked to do. That's why ever since then, us adding applications is very seamless because they're just more applications on top of our workflow engine. And now that's very easy for you to do because there's this low code, no code approach where you could also access this power of this automation engine behind the scenes. What I'm showing today is an example of this. This is almost like an if this, then that type interface to be able to write. And I've worked with customers who have no Java experience, no background, no scripting background, and yet they're able to solve relatively complex workflows just by writing out these statements. So we're looking at one, for example, that would be user onboarding. This could be for Active Directory. So an example might be that you're interacting with a chatbot and you want to onboard a user. I'm a new employee. I want to add to a group or something else. And this would work through that process of getting that user information, checking to see if they exist. Are they in a group? Should we add them to the group, et cetera? So it's very, very easy to follow. And if I wanted to, I could add sections to this. So I could add logic. What do I want to do? I could add subflows, which are pre-created or smaller flows that you reuse often, like a shared library. Or I could actually run an action. And I really like, you know, here maybe we're going to add this to a group. Maybe at this point, I'm going to call up one of these many, 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 many actions. And we're adding a tremendous numbers of these. And these are very easy to build yourself as well. So I might do something like a Microsoft Teams and get that in here somewhere, Microsoft Teams and Teams Graph. So to your point about adding somebody to a team, maybe I add them to an AD group and then I create a team for that AD group and I add them into that. It's really is that easy. And as soon as I pick one of these items, then all I have to do is drag and drop from the left-hand side what users, what group names, things like that. So very, very easy to interact with. Behind the scenes, those actions that are calling out might be doing, in this case, it's Microsoft, so be calling PowerShell. So you even have access if you really want to get behind the scenes and really manipulate it, you can do that. And if I go to create an action by hand, so this would be a create a team for Microsoft spokes, this is where I can actually get in and make real modifications if I wanted to. So if you when we say low code, no code, no code at the beginning, and we're getting to the point here to where even your developers will feel comfortable getting these actions and building them or creating them or modifying them so that you can pick them from these lists. So a big fan of this approach. Let's go back into a typical use case though. So let's say that we are getting alerts about health of our environment. And this is to transition to start talking about another place on our platform that we can use AI ops and automation. And in this case, I have this view that shows me the health of my services. And I have some critical, most critical services here. I can go ahead and click on those, and those will show me a map, for example, of that environment. And I can see that I have a problem with my database. What I would do here is receiving some alerts and grouping them together. I would probably start to triage if something has changed more recently on this. So for example, this is a system that just became unhealthy recently. And I have a view of not only the alerts that are there, but also the changes that have occurred. And I can see that a change has occurred recently. And that's the sort of thing that I would start to triage and go down. Before I do that though, what we're able to provide you is a grouping of these alerts. So we've grouped together multiple alerts together into one grouping. We have a root cause alert that we point you to, again, using our data models or AI ops. We're also using natural language understanding to point you to knowledge base articles. So if I open this knowledge base article and attach it, I would probably find that this is going to tell me exactly how to handle this, essentially look for changes, and ultimately end up running a automation. And so in this case, this is a low disk space is essentially the root cause of this service outage. And in this case, I have an automation that's presented to me, expand the disk space. Couldn't be easier. I can get to this either through the knowing to check the actions area, through the knowledge base articles, pointing me in that direction. Or in fact, if we have a set of criteria that is met, so certain type of alerts or certain types of criteria, then it could automatically run this remediation. And I don't even need a operator to be able to run this expand disk space. So if I run this, this is going to go to clean everything up. I'm going to show some additional areas in the platform that we're showing AIOps. And we'll come back to that expand disk space in just a few moments. So one of the things that my knowledge base article is telling me to do is to go check to see what's the root cause. Don't just immediately fix the problem because maybe expanding the disk space isn't really getting to what the issue is. So I might be looking at several things. Again, we saw in that service map, there was a change that happened more recently. So let's look back at that. There was a change here I saw happen just recently about the same time. And I bet you if I go into our topology map, this gives me that timeline view. We were healthy for a while, then we became unhealthy. And I look at the comparison, that's actually going to bring me up, hey, of your entire service, really only one thing changed. And it was this file for this application, this Oracle. And immediately I started getting some alerts on it. That's why it's pointing me in that direction as a root cause. And it points me even further. It's able to bring up those tracked configuration file details, difference it for me and say, actually, this is exactly what changed. At some point here, somebody set SQL trace to true. And what this might tell me is that this is expanding that disk space. This is what happens. This is a real life use case that I've had happen multiple times. It might be a change from a while ago. It might take a while to fill up, but we still have that historical view here. We're able to see at some point in the past, somebody set this to SQL trace equals true or debug mode. That is a tremendous amount more logging and has eventually filled that disk space. One thing this is not showing me is the who made that change. Because this is a detected change. This is a very key part that we're not actually going in and saying, if you have a change request, we can tell you who it is. But if we don't have a change request, we can't. We're actually getting this information directly from the servers, directly from the applications. So maybe they even forgot to put in a change request. Maybe they made this change off the books and we're still able to get visibility into that. I was a customer before, and this was a tremendous value to me to identify what the true root causes are. So we're getting a lot closer. It's starting to tell me through AI ops and through the data on the platform and all the information that we gather that the disk space is expanding, and I have something set for debug that's going to be using up a lot more space. So what I would do generally now is come back, and I would go to what we call our Alert Insight view, which is a button right off there off the Insights. And what this is going to do is show me the insight, the incidents, the changes, and the problems related to this service. And so the reason why that's helpful for me is maybe somebody did a change request and we detected that change, but maybe that change is on something related to it. Maybe they did a change on the application. And so this would be one place I would go to look to see, did they actually do a change and did that change break something? And again, getting back to that root cause. And our very next version will actually rebrand this as root cause and make this available directly onto that that alert view. So that'd be very helpful. So at this point, I've sort of identified that I have a knowledge base article that's helpful and I'm going to attach that. I have a root cause that's identified and looking into the details, it's pointing me to that that does seem to be an issue. And I'm gonna go ahead and expand that disk space while we're here. So I'll go ahead and run this remediation. That remediation is going to go off, and just like we saw with that Flows Designer, it's going to do the exact same thing. It's going to go out and essentially check to see if it's a Linux or Windows server. It's going to go and expand its disk space, and then it's going to come back with a completed or not completed. And we have modifications that we can do there. If it's not able to resolve the issue, we can get an operator back involved again. If it's able to do it, then we can move on. That's going to essentially set my my view back to green here in my operator workspace when it starts to clean everything up. While that's doing what it's doing, I want to talk about a different version of this. What happens if we actually knew the user that made that change? What happens if, while I want to remediate this issue, I still want to get to the root cause with that team and say, well, they still have SQL trace equals true on. They still have debug turned on. If they leave it on, it's going to continue to gather those logs and fill that disk space. And we're just going to be back at this position again in a month. So what I might do is look at our DevOps environment. So maybe what they're doing is they're using the DevOps CI/CD pipeline to actually push those changes out. And here's my DevOps dashboard. I can dive into my DevOps pipeline visualization. And whether they're using planning tools, whether they're using a GitHub, whether they're using a Jenkins to go push those changes out, or some other system, we're able to pull that data in. And in this case, we'd be able to identify that the change that occurred, because what happens before we deploy is that there's automations that push back into ServiceNow and create a change. So I would have an automated change there, and that change will describe exactly what's going to happen, the exact commit. And then through my work items, I'd know exactly who that developer was. And so this is giving me that attribution all the way back to the story and the person assigned to the story. I'm assigned to the story, so I guess I have to look at myself to solve this problem. But if I go and view this change, it's giving me all that detail at the bottom. Give us a moment to load. And I get all the information about this change. This would be available to your operator, as we saw that Insights view gave me access to those changes. And if I look down here at my commits in the change, and I open up those commits, this would be just another version of a difference and showing me this is what's changed here. And we're pulling this in from GitHub and from Jenkins and the CI/CD pipeline. So if I go back, we now have a healthy service here, healthy order status. It's gone to yellow. It's actually dependent on another service, and that's why it's turned yellow and not fully green. But if I go into that service, that alert is now closed. But if I go back to that alert insight, this is where we'd see that automated change. So that's a way to automate that change process. So you're not relying on just users to go and hand type in the changes, or always for us to find it through our ITOM visibility. So with that, spend all day on fun automations. Wanted to go through a couple automation use cases that we're finding. Based on the customers that we're working with, we're finding, and I think, Dan, we wanna work on this together. Some of these are ITSM related. Some of these are more ITOM related. I'll start on the right-hand side. I like the last one, 21, monitor Oracle databases. That was the issue that we were just dealing there, identifying Juniper router issues, Cisco router issues, VPN issues. I'm working on Zoom monitoring right now. Zoom and Teams and working from home apps are very helpful. And obviously anything dealing with notification to groups. And so if you want to automate the process to notify individuals, put people into a Slack channel together or into a Teams channel and have them start to communicate, resolve remotely, that's actually very helpful right now, as well as taking action on any other system. So you saw earlier, we have all of those actions, all those integration hub spokes that we can pull as automations that you can use in your flows. So there's a tremendous list there, and that's growing all the time. We release those every month. And that gives me the ability to look through that list and see even the spokes that are not yet installed in your instance, and to see what you can automate with each of those actions.
Now, whereas those ones that Christian just presented on the right-hand side are automations that help us prevent things that are mostly on the machine side of the house, the ones on the left are things that typically we enable via the virtual agent and help our customers expose to their stakeholders opportunities from a self-service, create those smarter self-service experiences. So if you just look at that list there, those 28 on the left-hand side, those are actually the pre-built virtual agent conversations that we offer that are listed out. So with many portions of the platform, one of the benefits that you get as a ServiceNow customer is you get content, common content that we see across our customer base, and we continue to add to that library. So with the analytics, we give you hundreds of KPIs aligned to the different processes. With the machine learning component, we give you a bunch of different solutions like the auto categorization and assignment, or the similar resolved and open. Those are pre-built templates to get you going. Same is true with the virtual agent here, which is those automate to deflect pieces. So if you look at those lists, if you were thinking about rolling out a virtual agent or any sort of conversational interface in your organization, would those be the things that you'd be interested in doing? And very often when I pose that question to customers, they come back with, yeah, this is exactly what we're looking to do. For example, that check IT ticket status. I was working with a customer just the other day, and they told me that 20% of the tickets that come into their service desk are simply people just checking the status of their existing tickets. So if you think about it, is the virtual agent going to catch all 20% of those? No, but even if it was used by people to knock off 5% of those, that's a huge win for folks getting out of the gates. And you certainly have the ability to author above and beyond this list from a conversational perspective with the virtual agent, but those are the ones that we provide you to get you going. And then there's the next piece.
Yeah, and so we have a program right now that's going on, and this is just one of many ways to identify potential use cases. We have the ability to pull in data into our predictive intelligence analysis. And essentially, this uses machine learning to look at your existing data. So maybe this is tickets or requests, and then be able to cluster those and group those together and give you ideas of the numbers of users. And maybe you can do this through simple analytics and simple reporting. But when you have larger data sets, sometimes this is helpful to get that clustering. And then again, start to point us towards those use cases that we showed you in the last slide. And this is actually using our platform to do this. So this is on our platform, leveraging our own AI and ML capabilities.
So this is the type of thing that uses your own, I'll go back to that one. This is the type of thing that uses your own data to identify opportunities. It's a program that we're running right now. So if you are a ServiceNow customer and you're interested in leveraging clustering to help you identify opportunities, reach out to your account team and tell them that you're interested in clustering analytics, and we can get the program started at your account.
So Dan and Christian, thank you very much for that deep dive into both our intelligence capabilities, as well as how can we automate our back office business processes to really help transform how IT delivers services. And what really resonates, I think, for a lot of our customers, as we go along this response journey is the first phase, really to react to something. And the readiness phase is really what we're talking about, is how can we start automating and streamlining our business processes, our delivery of our services. In this example, we went deeper into the IT organization, as there are a lot of times a backbone in the delivery of our mission. But as well as how can I leverage all that data that lives in the system to drive that transformation, right? What Dan really dived deep into is how can I really transform the delivery of that service, understand areas of improvement, and have data-driven decisions in our ability to be ready for that next event, and opportunities for maybe having machines talk to machines, less human intervention between some of these processes, and more efficiencies as we are expected to do more with less. And it's kind of the trend in government, where we're expected to do more in more adverse circumstances, but with less budgets, right? So more automation can really help drive some of those business objectives. So thank you very much for participating today in this conversation. I think the next session is really how can we extend those platform capabilities to our end customers? How can we transform the delivery of services external to organizations, to our constituents and citizens? leveraging all the things that we already looked at, right? That workflow automation, machine learning, a better user interface, leveraging all that legacy data and transforming the business processes, and extend that out to our front office or engagement with our end users and constituents. So thank you very much for joining this session, and look forward to seeing you tomorrow for our next session.